all auspiciousness, blessedness, and all powerfulness. It is merciful, it is beautiful, and so on and so forth. So that is the important difference between this this idea of nirguna and saguna. So for the Advaita, Brahma is pure consciousness, it is nirguna only. They accept saguna only as a, as we will see later, that as it is a, as it is in not real, but as mithya, that it is temporary. And for a realized person, when the person realizes the nitya, shuddha, buddha, mukta, brahma, everything else becomes zero or not. Everything else disappears. There is only the pure awareness of the param brahma. So this is the Advaitin's idea of Brahma Swarupam. So related to this is, of course, the relationship between, the next important point in Vedanta is the relationship between Brahman and Jagat. So the Upanishads are very clear that the Brahma is the instrumental cause as well as the material cause of the universe. So very briefly, I will explain what is the meaning of instrumental and material. For example, when a carpenter makes a chair or a table, then the wood that the carpenter uses is the material cause, okay? Because the wood changes to the chair or table, etc. And everything else other than the wood is the instrumental cause. For example, the carpenter himself, all the tools that the carpenter uses, and if somebody has employed the carpenter to do that, the employer also is an nimitta karana, instrumental cause. Similarly, space, time, everything else other than the wood can be called as the instrumental cause, as long as they are necessary for the production of the chair or table. So that in a nutshell is the material cause and the instrumental cause. Now the Upanishads are very clear that Brahman is the material cause as well as the instrumental cause of the universe. There are many Upanishad statements to that effect. Okay. But what the commentators do is they ask certain questions based on their understanding of the Brahma Swarupa, and they find some contradictions. Later on we will see that why Vishishtadvaita and Dvaita, they really do not accept the Brahman as the material cause. They do accept it as the instrumental cause because it is the all-powerful entity that creates this universe, but it is not the material cause in the sense that Brahman does not transform into the Jagat. Okay, so the other acharyas say that the Brahman does not transform into the universe because Brahman cannot change. Brahman is pure, so any vikara, any idea of vikara, militates against the very swarupa of Brahman in their view. All right. So therefore, as far as the relationship between Brahman and Jagat in the Advaita view, Brahman is neither the instrumental cause nor is the material cause. This is a very unique view, because what they say is the entire universe consisting of the various creatures, their samsara, the bandha, moksha, and all the various phenomena that we see in this world are mithya or unreal. They are superimposed on the pure Brahman as a result of the ignorance of the jiva. Okay, so this Brahman, as far as the Advaita is concerned, is neither the instrumental cause nor is it the material cause. So related to that, of course, is the point number 3. What is the relation between Brahma and jiva? So, in Vedanta, these are the three main objects of discussion and vimarsha: Brahma, Jagat, and Jivas. Brahma, Jagat, and Jivas. So, coming to the relation between the Brahma and the Jivatmas, here also the Advaitins have a very unique position, because for them, this entire universe consisting of the matter, the achetana and chetana, which are the jivas, are really do not exist. they are superimposed on the pure, they are imagined by the jiva because of ignorance. So the question is, so who has done the superimposition? So they say that there is really no jiva. So what is happening is only Brahman exists. And by some, in a very mysterious way, the Brahman itself is imagining this entire universe consisting of Chetana and Achetana objects, as in the form of the jiva. So when this jiva, whether it is you or me or anybody else, when that jiva, by means of concentrated sadhana on the pure consciousness of Brahma, when that person realizes Brahma within himself or herself, then what happens is, then that person realizes that there is, the universe itself does not exist. It is unreal. Obviously, as long as the person is alive and, you know, is eating three times a day and living the life like any other person, it cannot be unreal in a literal sense. But that is the fundamental realization of the Mukta Jiva, that he finds that the universe is unreal. And therefore, once the body falls, then what happens is, there is no jiva. Basically, the Brahman realizes itself in a sense. In effect, what the Advaitin is saying is that there are no jivas actually. So this entire prapancha is in a sense is unreal, and it is imagined because of the anadi ignorance of the jiva. Okay, so this is a very complicated subject, and within the Advaita Parampara only there are differences of opinion as to what is meant by mithya. See, the entire difficulty in the Advaita centers around the definition of mithya. Okay, as you can imagine, once we have said that the universe is unreal, which means everything is unreal. The person speaking is unreal. The speaking about Advaita is unreal. His thoughts and ideas are unreal. So basically, it is a kind of circular thing where it is impossible to finally arrive at any conclusion whatsoever. So this is a fundamental issue with Advaita that many other acharyas have said. For example, Acharya Ramanuja said that the problem with Advaitins is that they really do not have any means of valid knowledge, because once they have declared that everything is unreal, they have basically relinquished any means of real knowledge. So this is somewhat of an issue that exists with Advaita, which people have been struggling to understand for more than 1,000 years. And even today there are debates that happen as to how one can say that the Jagat and Jivas are mithya or unreal, because it goes against the experience of everybody. And also the Upanishads also never really say that the Jagat is mithya. It is essentially it is something that the Advaita commentators with great skill try to propound by interpreting the statements of the Upanishads in a particular way. Okay. So we do not have time to go into all of that. What we will do is we'll simply look at just one important Mahavakya, that is Tattvamasi, as to how it is interpreted by the three Acharyas. So we saw in the Advaita system, what the Brahma Swarupa, Jagat, the relation of Jagat with Brahma, and the relation of Jivas with Brahma. So based on that, they interpret Tattvamasi as, the Tat is that, the Brahma, the Supreme Soul, which is pure consciousness, changes, there is no problem there. So what is this you? So this you is the same Brahman which appears as the Jiva, and due to its association with the upadis, like body, sense organs, etc., It forms various ideas about itself and the universe. Okay. So for a realized person, this ignorance disappears, and along with it, any idea of being a separate jiva, that is Brahma, in a sense, rediscovers or realizes itself. So here one analogy can be given. For example, every night when in our sleep, we have dreams. So when the dream is going on, for us, everything is real in the dream. Many times we suddenly wake up, we are shocked by something that and surprised by something that happened in the dream. But when we wake up, what happens? We realize that everything, every character, everything, every scenario that we saw in the dream was completely unreal. It lasted only as long as the dream lasted. As long as we awakened, okay, it disappeared, and we are convinced 100% that it was only a dream and unreal, that we do not think too much about it. Similarly, what they say is that it is like waking up from a dream. So for the realized person, that person realizes that this all this prapancha with all its complexities and everything, though it has a logic of its own, but in the end, for a person who directly experiences the Supreme Consciousness, he realizes that this whole prapancha is unreal. Okay. So the question is from why, so what is the next question is regarding the rise of ignorance. It is an important topic in Vedanta that is discussed by everybody. Why are we ignorant? So where is, from where this ignorance comes? So all the three acharyas are agree that this avidya or ignorance is the very nature of creatures and has no beginning. It is anadi. So from anadi kala, the jivas are bound. Okay. From anadi kala, the jivas are bound because they're engrossed in the pleasures of the world. And it is only when they turn their attention inwards and become aware of a higher consciousness and a higher entity, that is the self that is there inside them, and then they begin the process of sadhana, and finally when they realize, when they have this personal experience of this inner deity, then what happens? Then from the Advaita point of view, the world ceases to exist. Then one is immersed in pure consciousness, in pure awareness, in pure Satchidananda. Okay. So this avidya is anadi as far as the all the three matacharyas are concerned. So coming to the next. So this is one of the main points in Advaita. How to remove ignorance? So what they say is, I gave an analogy of the dream and seeing experiencing something in the dream, and then after waking realizing that whatever was experienced was unreal. Similarly, they always give one more example, analogy, which is of the snake and the rope. For example, when there is insufficient light and from afar we see a snake, we think that is a snake, and we immediately become afraid and we move two steps back. But then we say, let's see what it is. Then we go nearer and nearer, and then we eventually see that, are this is only a piece of rope. This is not a snake. Then what happens? Then all our fear is vanished. And all what we thought was real before this realization, everything vanished. The snake vanishes. So what is left? Only the reality of the rope is left. So then the person who thought that he had seen a snake is liberated and becomes free from fear and ignorance. So similarly, they say that due to the eternal ignorance or avidya, we experience the universe and are convinced of its reality and live in fear and misery and pain and whatnot. Okay, so but by constant dhyana or meditation on Brahman, and that is what the Upanishads teach us, various kind of upasana of Brahman. By means of Omkara, and by means of, so there are some several other means of upasana of Brahman. So by that Brahman, upasana of Brahman as pure consciousness, we can remove the falsehood of universe that is superimposed on Brahman and realize the pure Brahman consciousness. So the term that they use for the superimposition is adhyasa, that this act of superimposition of this wrong ideas like the existence of the universe and the existence of the multiplicity of jivas and the multiplicity of objects and all the phenomena that we see and experience. So all these are superimposed, and this act of superimposition is called adhyasa or adhyaropa. Then what happens? Then what are we supposed to do? The Advaitin says that we are first supposed to, under the guidance of the Guru and by the meditation on the Veda Vakya, we are supposed to understand on what is real and what is unreal. So first we have to completely convince ourselves that whatever that we think is real is actually a adhyasa or superimposed thing on the pure consciousness of Brahman. So once we have convinced ourselves about, once we have discriminated about what is real and unreal, then we need to systematically remove this superimposition. So this act of removal of this unreal that is covering the real. So this act of removal of the unreal that is covering the real pure consciousness of Brahman is called apavada, the removal. So first we have to understand this adhyasa as to how our ideas about reality, about multiplicity and whatnot, this phenomenal reality is only a superimposition on the conscious, on the pure Brahman. And then by constant act of meditation under the guidance of a guru and with the help of the Shruti Vakyas, we are supposed to systematically remove that wrong ideas. And then what we will experience is the pure consciousness of Brahman. So this is how we remove, so this is how we attain moksha. So the interesting thing about Advaita eventually, and that is what Acharya Gaudapada says in his Karika. Hey, listen, my dear friend, there is really no universe, therefore there is no jiva, there is no bandha, there is no moksha also. Just like in a dream, when we come out of the dream, nothing really exists, isn't it? So in the Life Divine, Sri Aurobindo reviews this particular position of the Advaitin and makes the following remark. But for the I'm reading out what Sri Aurobindo has written in the Life Divine. He says, but for the illusionist, that is for the Mayavadi, so the universe is Maya. So that is a term you will hear very much only from the Advaitins. Okay. So this universe is a product of Maya. So for the Advaitin, this Maya is a sort of unreal. Whereas Ramanujacharya and Madhvacharya will say that one or two places in the Vedanta where Maya, in Veda and Vedanta where Maya occurs, this Maya is nothing but the power of Brahman. Okay. So this universe, when the Veda uses the term Maya, it is in the sense of this inscrutable power of Brahman, which manifests this amazing universe, which is with its infinite wonders and properties, of which we are able to understand only a little. So it is because it is inscrutable, it is not really finally understandable to us. That is why the term Maya is used. But for the Advaitin, the Maya is just like an illusionist. For example, when a magician, he shows something and everybody thinks that it is real, but eventually the magician makes it disappear. And then everybody knows that, you know, it did not really exist, something like that. So Sri Aurobindo says, but for the Mayavadi or the illusionist, the individual soul is an illusion and non-existent, except in the inexplicable mystery of Maya. Therefore, we arrive at the escape of an illusory non-existent soul from an illusory non-existent bondage in an illusory non-existent world as the supreme good, which that non-existent soul has to pursue, exclamation mark. For this is the last word of the knowledge as far as the Advaitin is concerned. There is none bound, none freed, and none seeking to be free. Okay, it is very important that we understand this particular concept, central concept of Advaita, that there is none bound, none freed, and none seeking to be free. Just like when we wake up from the dream, do we even bother to analyze what happened in the dream? No, because we are convinced that it is completely unreal. Therefore, for Advaitin, the person who realizes the true nature of Brahman by experience, he realizes that there is nothing at all, only Brahma, only I am there, and I am Brahman. Okay, so there was really no universe, no jivas, there is no bandha, there is no moksha, there is nothing. So this is the sort of extraordinary view of the Advaitins. So, as I said before, within the Advaitin parampara also, there are at least two or three different views on this nature of reality, the meaning of mithya. So we will not go too much into that, because that itself is many hours of discussion. So the next point, we have seen how to remove ignorance or avidya by the process of understanding first the nature of the superimposition, that is adhyasa, and by means of dhyana on the shruti vakya, and with the help of the guru, we are supposed to, by the process of apavada, remove that covering of ignorance that covers the pure consciousness. So the sixth point is, what is reality? What is the nature of the reality that we experience? So this, again, I'm telling you, is a very, it's extraordinarily vast topic. And not only in our parampara, but in Western philosophy also, this has been discussed in depth, and it's a very vast topic. So we will have a very, very high level view of it right now. So from the Advaita point of view, there are two orders of reality, two major orders of reality, Paramarthika and Vyavaharika. Paramarthika is the highest reality, which is of course the only reality from their point of view of Brahman as the Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta entity, Satchitananda. And the Vyavaharika, or the phenomenal reality, is the second order of reality, and this reality consists of everything. Okay, entire universe, Ishvara, all devatas. So from the Advaita point of view, even the Vedas are unreal, obviously, because once you have accepted that the universe is unreal, then everything other than Brahman, all the devatas, Agni, Indra, Varuna, Vayu, beginning from them, from the Rigveda onwards, all the other, everything ceases to be real. Okay, so this all that is phenomenal reality, which disappears from the Advaitic point of view on the realization of Brahman. So furthermore, they say that this reality ceases to exist for a Brahman realized person, and hence is called mithya. Mithya, they say, is a mixture of satya and asatya. Anirvachaniya, unexplainable. Once again, if you look at the example of dreams. So what is dream? Is it completely unreal? It is not, because whatever we see, we have experienced before. I mean, it is not 100% unreal. It consists of characters and situations, all that we have experienced before. But there is a new combination. There are new scenarios that are worked out, that are unreal. So it is in a sense a mixture of satya and asatya. In other words, anirvachaniya means unexplainable. So these are the two orders of reality from the Advaita point of view, Paramarthika and Vyavaharika. And this Vyavaharika or phenomenal reality is only temporary. It exists only as long as we are under the spell of ignorance. For a realized person, it ceases to exist. Okay. So the next point is, what is the cause of diversity of human swabhava? What is this business about? Business of karma and rebirth. Now, obviously, for the Advaitin, these are all part of the phenomenal reality. And it all this exists, as it was said before, from anadikala. So this from anadikala, because of the variety of karmas that the jivas do, they undergo different kinds of births, human birth, animal birth, sometimes birth as devata also, and sometimes as plants also. So these are the four kinds of births that a jiva can have. And it all depends upon the accumulation of karma and the karma phala. And so as long as the person is involved in, the outside phenomenal world, there is going to be karma phala leading to rebirth, which leads to more karma and karma phala and more rebirth. So that is the cycle. So this part is same for all the acharyas. Everybody agrees that from anadikala, jivas are involved in ignorant. They do karma in an egoistical way. So the karma phala attaches to them. Therefore, it results in rebirth. And the cycle of rebirths will continue until they realize the ultimate truth. So meanwhile, they can go to Swarga or Naraka and whatnot. They can go to a variety of lokas also. But ultimately, they will be reborn on earth. Okay. So that is the cause of the diversity of human swabhava. And that is the cause of the cycle of karma and rebirth. So what is the status of jiva after moksha? This is the eighth point. What is the status of jiva after moksha? For the Advaita, it is very simple. Advaitin, it is very simple. The jiva realizes that it is Brahman. In other words, the Brahman realizes that it is Brahman. That because of some mysterious, under the mysterious influence of some upadhis, okay, that because of the sense organs and the body and everything, it had got entrapped in this unreal phenomenal world. Okay, so when that particular jiva has the experience of the Brahman consciousness, then obviously there remains only Brahman, there is nothing else. Here also, they give a very interesting analogy. They say that, for example, they say, imagine a lot of pots, ghata, okay, they are empty. So each pot is like an individual jiva. So inside the pot, there is a space enclosed within the pot. Okay, so that let's call it pot space. And outside the pot, also there is space. That is the general space, universal space. So as long as the pot remains intact, one can speak of the pot space and the universal space. What happens when that pot breaks? There is only universal space only. There is no such thing as, so that particular individual pot space has gone. Okay, so something similar is the situation, one can say, of the jiva after moksha in the Advaita situation, where essentially the Brahman realizes itself. Okay, so basically the dream ends and the person realizes that, you know, that whatever was experienced was unreal. So finally, the all important question that lot of very brilliant philosophers have asked, not only in our culture but everywhere: what is the purpose of this universe? And more importantly, what is the purpose of man in this universe? Now, we are all students of Aurobindo, so I think we are fully acquainted with this particular point and what Sri Aurobindo has to say, the evolution and everything, and ultimately the the purpose of manifestation of the universe, according to Sri Aurobindo, is that through the medium of man, the Supreme Being seeks perfection in this universe. But in the case of Advaita, there is really no purpose. Other than we can say that for the Brahman in some mysterious way has gotten lost itself in this phenomenal reality. And the purpose of the manifestation is to essentially to come out of that phenomenal reality and realize itself. Okay. So this is a very interesting, view. There is no purpose because the Brahman, no real purpose because the Brahman does not manifest the universe. So in some mysterious way, the Brahman finds itself enmeshed in the phenomenal reality, which disappears when the Jiva realizes itself, its true Swarupa. Okay. So this completes the 9 points of the major issues in Vedanta with regard to the Advaita. This is, of course, a very high-level view. And because of the constraints, we can... But this gives a very, very, very interesting, very nice way of condensing the subject matter of the Vedanta into some easy points based on which we can compare the various views. Now, let's come to the Vishishta Advaita of Acharya Ramanuja. As you know, several centuries after Shankaracharya came Acharya Ramanuja. And he was, of course, a very strong opponent of the Mayavada. So according in the system of the Vishishta Advaita of Ramanuja, the Brahma Swarupan is not Nirguna, but Saguna. Not just Saguna, it has infinite Kalyana Gunas. It is all powerful and perfect. Okay. And not only that, the Jagat and the Jivas are the integral part of Brahman. It is very important to understand this point because later our Madhvacharya will say that Brahman, Jagat and Jivas are eternally separate from one another. Though, of course, the Jagat and the Jivas are eternally dependent upon Brahman, but they are separate. But in the case of Acharya Ramanuja's view, the Jagat, the universe and the infinite Jivas, they are all an integral part of Brahman. We will see how exactly it is. Okay. So in the case of Acharya Ramanuja, the Brahman has infinite Kalyana Gunas. All powerful, perfect, etc., etc., without any taint, pure, etc. So, Brahman and Jagat. So, what does this say about Brahman and Jagat? So, Acharya Ramanuja says Brahman is instrumental cause and also the material cause of the universe and Jagat and the Jivas. Okay, very clearly he says. Why does he say that? Because what we find, at least from my point of view, Acharya Ramanuja does the most justice to the Upanishads only in the sense that he takes whatever the Upanishad says without giving it a lot of interpretation. He says, because the Upanishad clearly says that Brahman is instrumental cause and material cause also. Therefore, he accepts it. So, but he accepts it in a certain way. Okay. And what is that? That is what we need to very carefully understand. Because that is where there is a big difference between Vishishta Advaita and the Dvaita of Madhvacharya. So, he says that all the Chit and Achit, Achetana and the Chetana Prapancha, the Jivas and the universe of matter, they constitute the body of Brahman and exist as modes or prakaras of Brahman. Okay. So, Brahman exists as the antaryami within each Jiva and within each object in the universe. Okay. And the individual Jivatmas, the individual souls, as well as their bodies, as well as the achetana bodies, they all form the modes or prakaras of the Brahman. All right. So at pralaya, what happens? All the jivas and all the material universe, it goes back to the state of unmanifested state within Brahman. So the jagat and the jivas exist eternally as the prakara or mode of Brahman. This is a very subtle point that he makes that we need to understand. So in my point of view, he does not really consider the Brahman as the material cause of the universe. Instrumental, yes, no problem. Because he says that the prapancha of jivas and the universe, they exist eternally, even in the pralaya kala, as in an unmanifested state within Brahman. Okay. So he does not accept the modification of Brahman as jagat or jivas. We need to carefully understand this. But still in his vakyana, he will say that it is upadana, it is Brahman is the upadana karana also, that is the material cause also. And he will clarify it by a particular explanation. So he says, for example, if you take the, let's go and look at the Brahman and the Jivatma. So the Jiva's individual souls are distinct from each other, but their essential nature of knowledge and bliss, Ananda, is the same. So Jiva is the Antaryami of the body and Brahman is the Antaryami of the Jiva. Similarly, Brahman is the Antaryami of every Achetana object also. So Brahman exists in this universe as the Antaryami, and it is qualified by the particular individual soul and the particular individual body. I will repeat this again. So in this universe, Brahman exists as the Antaryami in each Jiva. And in each Jiva, the Antaryamin Brahman is qualified by the individual soul and the individual body. Therefore, he is Vishishta. Hence the term Vishishta Advaita of Acharya Ramanuja. So what does Advaita mean? Advaita means not two or more, only one. And that is what the Upanishad teaches. So Upanishad teaches that this Brahman, Jagat and Jivas are all actually one. There is a grand unity that one is supposed to understand. The whole purpose of the Upanishads is to show us in what fashion they are one. Okay. So Advaita. The Upanishads indeed teaches Advaita. But what Shankara does is he does not accept the reality of the universe and the Jivas. Okay. But Acharya Ramanuja says that the Jivas and the universe are also real. And not only that, they are an integral part of Brahman. Okay. So therefore, in the Mahavakya Tattvamasi, the Tat means the Supreme Soul, Brahman, Vishnu. So for... Please mute yourself, please. So for both Ramanuja and Madhvacharya, Brahman is the same as Vishnu. Okay. They are very clear on that. And there is plenty of support in the Vedanta also for that. So in Tattvamasi, as far as in Vishishta Advaita, the Tat is of course the Supreme Soul, Brahman, Vishnu. It is infinite, Kalyana Gunas, perfect, flawless, etc. And you, Tattvamasi, you are that. So understand this carefully. He says that in Tattvamasi, that Tvam or you is the same Brahman existing as the inner ruler or Antaryami of the individual selves and qualified by the individual self, Jivatma and the Sharira, as its mode or prakara. So that is how this Tattvamasi needs to be understood, and not absolutely literally. Okay, because in Vishishta Advaita, the individual soul is not exactly the same as Brahman, unlike in Advaita, and unlike in Sri Aurobindo system also. So he says that Tattvamasi means that the Brahman is actually each individual jiva, each individual human being, let's say, each individual human being is actually the Brahman as Antaryami, having the individual soul and the sharira of that person as modes or prakara. So that Antaryami Brahman is qualified by the individual self and the sharira. Similarly, every object in the universe is also Brahman, because Brahman exists as the Antaryami of that object also. So in the Achetana case, Brahman is the Antaryami, and the object and that Antaryami is qualified by that particular object. Okay, so that is how this Tattvamasi is explained by in the Vishishta Advaita scheme of things. So this is we need to understand this very carefully. So I'll just move on. So in the Vishishta Advaita of Ramanuja, so avidya or ignorance, what about it? As I said before, in the Vishishta Advaita also, the jivas, the infinite number of jivas, are their karma is anadi. Because it is anadi, tremendous amount of karma phala has accumulated. And based on their karma phala, they take various kinds of birth, human birth or animal birth, and so on and so forth. Okay. But here, in Vishishta Advaita has an interesting take on the jivas. So Ramanuja says that among jivas are also, there are three kinds. Those who are eternally mukta and never baddha. In other words, they have never been, those jivatmans have never been part of this universe. Okay. They are always in the company of Bhagavan Vishnu and always in the state of Ananda, being in the company of Vishnu in Vaikuntha. Those are the nitya mukta. Then there are the second kinds of jivas, or those who were in samsara at some point, okay, who underwent many births, but at some point they became mukta and now they are in the company of Bhagavan Vishnu in a state of ananda. So these jivas who were at some time they were in samsara, but now they are mukta. And finally, the third type is those like us who are still in samsara and who are undergoing repeated births because of the accumulation of karma phala, etc., etc. But what Ramanuja says is that every jiva has a chance of moksha. But this is not accepted by Madhvacharya. We will see that later. So according to Madhvacharya, there will be a certain X number of X percentage of jivas that will be nitya in tamas. Okay, we'll see that later. But from in Vishishta Advaita, these are the three kinds of jivas. Okay, and so the ignorance, as I said, they all agree that it is anadi karma phala, karma and karma phala, the cycle of ignorance and rebirth continues. So how do we remove ignorance? It is very simple. Both for Ramanuja and Madhvacharya, it is bhakti of Vishnu bhakti, complete surrender. Okay, but what they say is, first one must understand the truth, the nature of Bhagavan Vishnu Narayana, and the nature and the limitedness of each one of us jivas. Then what we have to do is, in a spirit of complete surrender to Vishnu Narayana, at some point, by the grace of Vishnu, we will be able to end this cycle of rebirth and be permanently in Vaikuntha in the company of Vishnu. So the grace of Vishnu is absolutely paramount. Okay, and that comes by total bhakti or surrender to Vishnu, and it is entirely up to Bhagavan Vishnu as to when he will, by his grace, lift that person up from the cycle of death and misery and take that person to the Vaikuntha. Right. So this is the bhakti marga, which exclusively that Acharya Ramanuja advocates. So our perception of reality, this is also simple. They say that because of this anadi, this karma, we live in ignorance. We are always looking outside. But whatever we know is not wrong entirely, unlike what the Advaitin says, that it is unreal. So in the system of Ramanuja, whatever we, you know, our sense organs and all, they, we have to rely on that. We have no other choice. There is no sense in saying that it is unreal or we cannot trust it. Because if we cannot trust it, then we cannot trust anything else, anything at all. So finally, he says that, but we only have half knowledge, and that the Upanishads, the Veda gives us the complete knowledge. And of course, by if you have the right guru and if you have the if your sadhana is done in a proper manner, then by the grace of Vishnu you attain moksha or release from this cycle of rebirth. So what is the cause of diversity of human sabhava? It is, once again, it's the same thing. It is the variety of karma, and you know that there is a diversity of human sabhava and there is rebirth. So what is the status of jiva after moksha? So here also it is important to note that, unlike the Advaita, here the both in the Vishishta Advaita and Dvaita, the jiva remains the individual soul even in the state of moksha, and even after having realized the ultimate reality, the jiva maintains its individuality. Okay, and even in the state of moksha, they are paratantra, they are dependent upon Brahman even after moksha. So the liberated jivas remain in eternal blissful union with Vishnu in the state of moksha. So this is the status of jiva after moksha. There is no merging. Okay, there is no merging. Okay, so finally, what is the purpose of the manifestation of universe and what is the purpose of man? So the universe, from the Vaishnava point of view, this creation of the universe is a leela of Bhagavan Vishnu. I think we are all familiar with that concept. But then again, what is the purpose? The purpose is that jivas get an opportunity. Remember that this infinite number of jivas are going along, are stuck in this cycle of rebirth for many cycles of the universe. Okay. So in each cycle of the universe, all the jivas that are not yet attained moksha, they get an opportunity to acquire the correct knowledge of God and their own self and realize their own nature and the nature of Vishnu and their relationship, and by bhakti attain moksha. So that is the purpose of the manifestation of the universe. So this completes the Vishishta Advaita of Ramanuja. So we'll move on to the Dvaita of Acharya Madhva. Once again, we will see Brahma Swarupam. So here, it is there are a lot of similarities between the doctrines of Advacharya and Ramanujacharya, but there are important differences also. So let's see what are those. Brahma Swarupam, again, for Madhvacharya, Brahman is Vishnu only, nothing else. And 100% it is Saguna, infinite auspicious gunas and glorious powers, which are beyond our understanding. We can only, in a spirit of servanthood, we can only approach Bhagavan Vishnu by our complete surrender. Then by the grace of Vishnu, we can have the realization of the Supreme Being. So Brahman is Svatantra. So in the system of Madhvacharya, one primary concept that he postulates is of Svatantra and Paratantra. Only Brahma is Svatantra. Brahman and Jagat and Jivas, they are eternally separate from Brahman, but are dependent upon Brahman, Paratantra, even for their very existence. Okay, so Brahman and Jagat. So here in this case, please understand now the difference between Acharya Madhva and Ramanujacharya. So for Madhvacharya, Brahman is only the instrumental cause and not the material cause of Jagat and Jivas, of the universe and Jivas. Okay, why? Because for Madhvacharya, Each individual jiva is different from other jiva. Jivas are different. We'll see. There are five kinds of differences that Madhvacharya postulates. And all those differences are eternal. Okay, from the beginning of time, etc. So, Brahma only by his willpower and by his supernormal power is able to manifest the Jagat and Jivas from their unmanifest state. So, in the cycle of Pralaya, Srishti and Pralaya, so in after Pralaya, the collection of Jivas and the universe of matter, they go back to their unmanifested state. But they are still separate from Brahman. Whereas in the case of Ramanuja, they are an integral part of Brahman and exist as his modes of being. Very important difference. Okay. So Jagat is different from Brahman, and Brahman by his will, by his power, he manifests the Jivas and the universe from their unmanifested states. Okay. Jagat and Jivas are Paratantra and cannot exist even for a moment without the support of Brahman. So Brahman and Jivatman, once again the same. The individual souls are unique. They are different from each other. And they are each different in their basic Swarupa or nature. Okay. So the Jiva Swarupa, the nature of the intrinsic nature of the individual soul, of each individual soul is different, is unique. Okay, and the Vishnu Brahman is the Antaryami of the Jiva, just like we saw in the case of Vishishtadvaita. So here comes the very unique contribution of Madhvacharya. He's very crystal clear about these things. He says there is Panchavida Bheda. Difference number one, the eternal difference between Brahma and universe, because their nature is different. Second difference is difference between Brahma and Jiva. Once again, that very nature is different. There is a little bit of, we will see how Brahma and Jivas are similar. So the third difference is the difference between universe and Jivas. Okay, so the Achetana Prapancha is entirely different from the Chetanas, from the Jivas. Fourth kind of difference between Jiva and Jiva. So one Jiva is very different from and unique compared to the other Jiva. Whereas in the case of Vishishtadvaita, the nature of Ananda and Jnana, knowledge and bliss, remains the same for all the Jivas in the system of Ramanuja. But here, each Jiva is unique. The level of knowledge and level of Ananda varies widely. Okay, we will see how. So Madhvacharya also divides the Jiva into three kinds. We will see how it is. So there is difference between one Jiva and other Jiva. Finally, the fifth kind of difference between one object and another object, one Jada and another Jada. So this is a very fundamental pillar of the Dvaita, or it is also called the Tattvavada, of propounded by Acharya Madhva, which is the Pancha Vidha Bheda, the fivefold difference between Brahma and universe, Brahma and Jivas, universe and Jivas, Jiva and Jiva, and Jada and Jada. Okay, very clear. Okay, so here comes the one more unique contribution of Madhvacharya in the form of Tattvamasi. Very clearly, Madhvacharya says that, my dear friend, it is not Tattvamasi, but it is Atattvamasi. So if you look at the text of the Upanishads, one can derive Atattvamasi also based on Sanskrit grammar. So Madhvacharya says that I can very easily derive Atattvamasi from the text. It is not Tattvamasi, but Atattvamasi, that you are not that. Okay. So why he says that? That is because in Madhvacharya's system, the Supreme Soul, Brahman, Vishnu, Narayana, is unimaginably superior to the Jiva. There can be absolutely no question of any equality between the Jiva and Brahman. Similar to Vishishta Advaita also. So Tattvamasi, that Tat means the Vishnu Narayana, the manifester and the support of the world, as infinite, auspicious qualities, perfect, powerful, etc., etc., etc. What about the Jiva? So he says that, Madhvacharya says that the Jivas exist separately, but as a Pratibimba or a minor reflection of Brahman. Okay, just as when the reflection of the sun is seen in a small piece of glass, for example, what do we see? That the glass is reflecting the sunlight. So that light and the light, the sun and the sunlight are same in one sense, but utterly different because they differ in their extent, they differ in their power and in their presence and also in their in their capacity. So therefore, Madhvacharya says is that each jiva is like a pratibimba of the Brahman. Therefore, it is utterly separate. Here, the pratibimba should not be taken in a very literal sense, because somebody will ask, what is reflecting that? What is causing that reflection? Okay, so all that questions cannot be asked. Is merely giving an analogy that just as the reflected light is a very, very, very tiny, insignificant part of the sun, power of the sun, similarly, each jiva is separate from the sun, okay, and an insignificant compared to the Brahman. All right. So in Tattvamasi, Madhvacharya clearly says it is you are not that. Atattvamasi. All right. So regarding avidya, so here also Madhvacharya says that it is the anadi accumulated karma that is causing the karma and the karma phala that causes the jivas to live in ignorance. So here comes one more fundamental contribution of Madhvacharya. He says that there is, as we have just seen, there is svarupa bheda among the individual jivas. There is a fundamental difference in the nature of the individual atma. And he provides a very logical and explanation to this. For example, everybody else says that, you know, this diversity of the jivas is caused by karma, karma phala, etc. But then Madhvacharya asks the question, why do they do different karmas? Why not the same kind of karma? So then one can say that, look, karma is the consequence of desire, kama. So the desires are different, therefore they do different. But that doesn't answer the question, because one has to, one can further ask, why do they desire things differently? So Madhvacharya says, finally, we have absolutely no choice but to accept that there is an intrinsic difference, svarupa bheda, of each individual soul in the universe. Okay, so this is how he arrives at that distinction. So he says that is the only way we can satisfactorily account for the wide diversities of people and their fate in this world. Furthermore, he says, just like Ramanuja, he says that there are three kinds of jivas. But the three kinds of jivas are different in the Dvaita system. He says, there is one category called Mukti Yogyas, those who are currently in bondage, who are in samsara, but who are qualified for moksha because of their superior abundance of sattva guna. Okay, so they are qualified for moksha, and at some point in some life they will attain moksha. Then there is a second category of jivas called Nitya Samsari, who have an excess of rajas guna, extreme rajas guna, because of which they are always involved in bhoga and bhoga and more bhoga. Therefore, they are Nitya Samsari, they are always reborn continuously in this particular universe as well as in every cycle of Srishti, Srishti Pralaya, every cycle in every srishti they will always be reborn only, no moksha for them. Finally, there are third kind of jivas who are tamoyogyas, who are eternally condemned to tamas or darkness, to hell. Even when they are born on this earth, okay, they will always go back to the place from where they came. That is hell. That is, they are so evil, they are so papi, that even after getting a chance to be born on earth as a jiva, they will always do evil acts and end up eventually not in swarga or not moksha, but once again go back to hell. So these are the, and this is where there is a lot of controversy, and Madhvacharya has been severely criticized by a lot of people, especially the modern people like us, who say, "Arey, why are you saying? How can Madhvacharya say that, you know, there can be people? This looks more like Christianity, where in Christianity, as you know, if you do not accept Jesus Christ and whatnot, and a Christian God, the God of the Bible, then what happens? You are condemned to eternal hell. End of story." So they say that, hey, this looks Madhvacharya's this tamo yogya, they look very suspiciously like the Christian doctrine. But many followers of Madhvacharya have made it clear that it's nothing to do with Christianity. It is Madhvacharya is basing his doctrine on what is already well known and accepted by everybody, which is that we are all Traigunya Vishaya, Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. So once we have accepted that we are Traigunya, then in the real world there are always going to be extremities, extreme cases in each case. So those who are extremely tamasic, they will never attain moksha. They will always, even when they are when they are born on this earth, they will once again go back to hell. Whereas the nitya samsari, by means of doing good karma, they can go to swarga or some other pitriloka or swarga loka, spend a lot of time there and come back into samsara and be reborn, etc., etc. Okay, so what Madhvacharya says is that his supporters say that Madhvacharya is not, it is not his personal view, or it is not his personal inclination in classifying these jivas as three kinds. They are actually, once you think logically, one has to conclude that these kind of three kinds of jivas are there based on the sattva, rajas and tamas gunas. Right. So how to remove ignorance? So here there is complete commonality with the Vishishta Advaita of Ramanujacharya, because both are Vaishnavites, and it is the complete surrender to Vishnu and to sing the infinite glories of Vishnu and understand the supra-normal and the ultimate Asankhya Kalyana Guna nature of unknowable nature of Vishnu, and understand that I as a jiva is an insignificant servant of the Vishnu, and therefore the only way for me as a jiva is to offer complete surrender and bhakti to Vishnu, and thus and hope that someday by the Vishnu, by his grace, will lift me up from this samsara and make me part of the eternally part of Vaikuntha. Okay, so bhakti marga is the only marga that is propounded by both acharyas Ramanuja and Madhvacharya. Obviously, in the case of Madhvacharya system, the nitya samsari and the tamoyagya shall never get moksha, that we have already seen. So let's quickly move on. So this perception of reality also, unlike the Advaita, there is no confusion here in the system of Madhvacharya also, that that what the universe we experience is real, but we lack the full knowledge. And it is the Veda that gives us the correct, the full knowledge of the glory of Bhagavan Vishnu, whether it is Veda or Itihasa and Purana, all these Sadgranthas taken together, they all declare the glory of Vishnu and the need for the Jiva to surrender himself to Bhagavan Vishnu if one is desirous of release from this samsara. So correct knowledge of the Supreme Being of Vishnu and the Jiva and Bhakti is required for moksha. So cause of diversity of human sambhava, karma and rebirth. So here is where, as we have already seen, Madhvacharya differs entirely. He says that each Jiva does unique karma because he has a unique desire. And he has a unique desire because intrinsically the individual Jiva itself is different in a very fundamental, in intrinsic way, Swarupa Bheda. This is the only way we can fully explain the diversity of Jiva Swabhava and the and karmas created done by the Jivas. Okay. Next, status of Jiva after moksha. So here also, just like Vishishtadvaita, even in the state of moksha, there is no merger. Each Jiva remains distinct and separate, not only from other Jivas, but also from Brahman. And here also, there is a difference in ananda and knowledge between each Jiva compared to the other, because of the reason we have already seen, that there is taratamya because of the intrinsic difference in the individual soul. There is ananda taratamya also. Not all the mukta jivas are in the same state of ananda, for the reason that has already been described, because they are intrinsically different. When they are intrinsically different, their moksha status also will be different. So this is to the extent which Madhvacharya propounds difference. Okay, therefore the Dvaita can also be called as the Bhedavada, though of course the Jivas and the Jagat are eternally dependent. They are paratantra to the Brahman, that is there. So what is the purpose of the manifestation? The purpose is that, again, in the Vaishnava philosophy, this universe is the Leela of Vishnu. And the purpose is that in each cycle, Jivas get a fresh opportunity to acquire the correct knowledge and realize their real self. Okay. And thus understand from the Shruti and from their gurus, the nature of Vishnu and the nature of Jiva, and by means of Bhakti Marga, attain the release from this cycle of birth, etc., etc. So this completes the Tattvavada or the Dvaita of Acharya Madhva. So now we move on to the integral Advaita of Sri Aurobindo. Just give me 1 second. Now what you will see here is, in each of these 9 points, how different Sri Aurobindo is in the level of detail to which Sri Aurobindo has investigated. Remember, regarding the life divine, he had said that it is not philosophy. So he is not arguing intellectually. He is saying that this is what I have seen and experienced, period. So let's remember this in our mind. So for each of these 9 points, Sri Aurobindo has much more to say than all those who came before him. For example, in the Brahma Swarupa, he says that the Brahma exists as the transcendental being, the supreme being, but it also devolves itself into the 7 planes of consciousness: Bhur, Bhuva, Svaha, Maha, Janaha, Tapaha, Satya. So this is the sevenfold sevenfold universe that he propounds. Again, this is not invented by Sri Aurobindo. This is there in our Itihasas and Puranas. It is just that Sri Aurobindo is the first person to go fully into this matter and to investigate. And finally, as we all know, his investigation came to an end with the realization of the supramental consciousness, the supermind, or the vijnana. So for in Sri Aurobindo's view of things, and in this is what the Upanishads also says, that the Brahma is saguna and nirguna at the same time. So nirguna, it is the transcendental form of Brahman, of the Supreme Being. Saguna is all this manifestation of this universe in this several planes of consciousness. Okay, so the Brahman is, later on we will see, he gives an explanation about nirguna and saguna, we will see. So Brahma Swarupa is infinite consciousness, satyam jnanam anantam Brahma, as the Taittiriya Upanishad says, that he is infinite existence, is infinite knowledge also. The question one has to ask is, what is that knowledge? If not of the universe or universes. So that knowledge is nothing but in unmanifested or in a condensed form, the transcendental Brahman holds the power to manifest not one or two, but even infinite number of universes. All right. So that is the Brahma Swarupa. It has infinite Shakti also. It is not merely consciousness. It is infinite knowledge, infinite energy also. All right. So this is the Upanishads are very clear on this. But Sri Aurobindo is the first one to make this crystal clear. So Brahma Swarupa, as we saw, that in Sri Aurobindo's description in the Life Divine, the supramental consciousness or the supermind, the Maharloka, the fourth loka from below, is extraordinarily important, because it is in the supermind that the one becomes the many. The Supreme Being, from his status of non-differentiated unity, starts differentiating itself into the many. This is a very big topic that one can read in the Life Divine, that there are three statuses in the supramental consciousness, where the supreme Brahman, from one it becomes the many. So in somewhere else he has stated in a somewhat poetic form that in the supermind, the supermind is the face of the Supreme Being turned towards creation. Okay, so the supermind is the face of the Supreme Being turned towards creation. The one becomes the many. In the supermind, in its own extension, it occupies infinite centers of consciousness, and with each center as the individual Jivatman. So thus there is mutual identity of Jivatmans, and also with the Jiva, with Brahman. Okay, why does it do that? It is for its own Ananda. Okay, so Brahman imagines itself in its own extension, in infinite centers of consciousness. So each center of consciousness is a unique view of itself and of Brahman and of the universe. So that unique view each Jiva has. All right. But the Jiva is non-different from the Brahman, because it is the Brahma itself which has manifested itself as infinite centers of consciousness, infinite centers of concentration of consciousness. Therefore, each Jivatma is identical with Brahman. And that is how that it is very easy to understand Tattvamasi in the case of the Sri Aurobindo's integral Jiva, integral Advaita, because of the way he investigated and understood the nature of the supermind and the nature of the rise of the Jivatma, how the Jivatma comes into being. All right. So the third point is, in its own extension, it creates the seed form of every object to be manifested. So in the Bhagavad Gita, we will find that he is the, Krishna says that he is the seed, ekavachana, sometimes he says seeds also. So, so in his form as the supermind, it holds the seeds for every object that eventually comes into existence in the universe. Okay, and each seed is called the real idea. And each real idea is has its own unique knowledge and power to manifest itself. Okay, and it turns itself into a real object and a real jiva within the universe. In the supermind, it exists only as a real idea. So I think it's enough for now. So finally, in the Sri Aurobindo's integral Advaita, the supermind or the fourth loka, Bhur Bhuva Svaha Maha. Okay, the supermind is the link between the higher triple and the lower triple. The lower triple is Bhur Bhuva Svaha, and the higher triple is Jana Tapa Satya. And the supermind is the link between the high, because in the supermind, the one becomes the many. So unless you understand the nature of supermind, you will not be able to understand the real heart of the Upanishads. Because the Upanishads propound that the Brahman, Jagat and Jiva is all form a unbreakable unity. It is all one. So one has to, unless one understands the nature of this, the manifestation of the universe, and in particular, the nature of the supramental consciousness, one will not be able to fully understand the heart of the Upanishads or Vedanta. All right. So this is the supermind. So finally, this is what Sri Aurobindo says about Saguna and Nirguna. He says, the impersonal divine, the Nirguna Brahman, and the personal divine, the Saguna Brahman or Vishnu, we can say, are here equal and coexistent aspects, okay, of the eternal. Impersonality can manifest with person subordinated to it as a mode of expression. But equally, person can be the reality with impersonality as a mode of its nature. Both aspects of manifestation face each other in the infinite variety of consciousness existence. So what he says is, there is absolutely no contradiction between Saguna and Nirguna. So it is a lack of understanding of the Brahma Swarupa that leads some philosophers to think as if Saguna and Nirguna are polar opposites of each other, but they are not. Okay. So so in this quote, we can see Sri Aurobindo's vision of the integral Brahman. And hence, his Advaita can be called as the Sampurna Advaita or the integral Advaita. Because it is only in Sri Aurobindo's vision that he has described in the Life Divine that we can very easily read the Upanishads and see that, you know, yes, this is what the Upanishad says. So while reading the Life Divine, you will see that, you know, without meaning to write a commentary on the Upanishads, the Life Divine is actually a commentary or a revelation of the Upanishads. This is my personal experience. So a lot of the things, the important concepts, the important precepts that the Upanishads propound, one can understand it in the Life Divine. So that is the unique achievement of Sri Aurobindo, that without any need of complicated vyakhyana, complicated explanation of the Shruti Vakyas, very simply we can understand the Shruti Vakyas as, we can fully understand it based on the details that Sri Aurobindo has provided in the Life Divine. So finally, this also Sri Aurobindo has said many times, Nirguna means beyond the gunas, but with the ability to manifest infinite qualities. This is the absolute power of the absolute. Okay, so this is what Sri Aurobindo says in one place in the Life Divine, where he very, very quickly reviews the the Mata of Shankara, Ramanuja and Madhvacharya. And then he says that the absolute power of the absolute cannot be contained by our imagination. See, so the Supreme Being, who is beyond space and time, has the ability to manifest itself in as infinite centers of consciousness. Why not? Who are we to tell the Supreme Brahman what it can and cannot do? Okay, simultaneously, it can be one and it can be many. And as he very Sri Aurobindo famously put it, the Supreme Being is infinitely one. The Supreme Being is infinitely one. That is, it is one in an infinite number of ways. Okay. So in all this diversity of expression in the universe, as the jivas and as the chetana and achetana objects in the universe, the Brahman itself is never ignorant. The Brahman always sees itself everywhere. Okay. In every particle of this universe, it sees itself. Okay. It sees itself. So therefore, this is how this famous analogy in the Chandogya Upanishad can be understood. Once we understand Sri Aurobindo's vision. So there it says that, in the Chandogya Upanishad, it says that from a lump of clay, we can make any number of various objects, pots and pans and murtis and whatnot. So this lump of clay is changed. Okay, it undergoes modification and becomes a lot of objects. And they're all real. To the lump of clay, they're all real. Because the lump of clay knows that these pots and pans and this ghata and this particular murti, I am only there everywhere. It's not different from me. Similarly, Brahma is always in full knowledge eternally of the unity. It sees itself everywhere. And that is what the Isha Upanishad also says. Yastu sarvani bhutani atmanyeva anupashyate sarva bhuteshu cha atmanam, etc. So, as Sri Aurobindo says, that this is the triple gospel. All in one, one in all, and all from one. All in the one. Okay. All and one in all. And all from one. So this is the fundamental teaching of the Upanishads. This is what the Upanishad, this is the real Advaita that the Upanishad teaches. Not mithya, not separation. And not separation as propounded by Madhvacharya, neither as separately as a mode or the prakara of the Brahman, but existing separately as a body of Brahman. Okay, none of that. That is actually the Upanishad teaches the complete and utter unity of all of those things. All these three things that we think that they are separate in our ignorance. But the very purpose of the Veda, purpose of the Upanishad is to teach us to understand the unity that is there and to live in that unity, as the Isha Upanishad very famously says. Okay. So this is a unique contribution of Sri Aurobindo, that without any convoluted vyakhyana, without resorting to any fancy etymology of the Sanskrit words, okay, without resorting to any such means to understand the import of the Upanishads, okay, by having a higher vision. So as Sri Aurobindo always says that if a person is reading the Upanishads or the Veda for that matter, and they think that this is contradictory, then he says, what you must do is you should go and examine your own understanding, rather than saying that, okay, this is contradictory, so by means of my logic, I will make some adjustments so that, you know, so this contradiction can be quote unquote removed. So So the idea is there is really no contradiction. The contradiction exists only because of our lack of understanding of the real knowledge of Brahma Swarupa. It's the manifestation of the Jagat and the nature of the Jivatma. All this we have seen, that how Sri Aurobindo has explained all of this. Right. So Brahman and Jagat. So what does Sri Aurobindo say about Brahman and universe? So this is also his very unique contribution. Okay. So as we all know, that his fundamental doctrine is that out of this dark inconscience, matter first evolved, then in matter life evolved, then within life mind evolved. And within the mind also, the highest form of mind so far is within the human being, which is why each human being has the Annamaya Kosha, Pranamaya Kosha, and the Manomaya Kosha. Okay. So this is where we are now. And in Aurobindo's scheme of things, this evolution is not complete. We are still a work in progress. And in the future, the Vijnana, the fourth loka, Bhur, Bhuva, Svaha, and Maha. Bhu is the Annamaya. Bhu corresponds to the Annamaya Kosha of human beings. Bhuva corresponds to the Pranamaya Kosha. Okay, and Svaha corresponds to the Manomaya Kosha. Also, the Bhuhu, which corresponds to the Annamaya Kosha, its primary guna is Tamaha of the Swarloka, of the Bhuvarloka or the Pranamaya Kosha. The primary quality is Rajas. And similarly, the mind, the quality of the mind is Sattva. It is of the Swarloka. And that is the Manomaya Kosha within us. So as we all know, in Sri Aurobindo's scheme of things, there is going to be a further evolution in which the Vijnanamaya Kosha will also develop, evolve in two ways. First, there is a evolution from within. So from within man, there will be a upsurge of this higher consciousness, but that cannot happen without the pressure from above, as Sri Aurobindo keeps saying. So it is the will of the Supreme Being. So the supermind is also all the time acting on this universe and on man. So by this ascent and descent, so the ascent of consciousness by the individual effort of human being, by sadhana, and by the descent of the higher consciousness into the human being, this Vijnanamaya Kosha will also develop. Right now, it is there it is sleeping, it is in an unevolved form, it is involved. So in the future, the Vijnanamaya Kosha will also evolve by this dual process of ascent and descent. Okay, we are all familiar with that. So this is a very, very, very unique contribution of Sri Aurobindo. And I think, in my opinion, it is because Sri Aurobindo lived in the modern times. So that also makes a difference. So when I look at the doctrines propounded by Shankaracharya, Madhvacharya, and Ramanujacharya, we see that they are also part of the milieu of those times, the culture and the level of knowledge that existed in those times. And they responded accordingly with their own individual genius and their own individual experience. So for Shankara, this transcendental consciousness, you know, is the ultimate. And in his vision, all that forms the phenomenal reality is inconsequential and exists only temporarily until the person realizes the transcendental consciousness, etc., etc. So based on their own conviction, on their own spiritual experiences, and based on the knowledge that prevailed at that time, they all propounded their own doctrines. So Sri Aurobindo, in the age which Sri Aurobindo lived, because of the fast advances that were happening in science, so the idea of evolution had gained much prominence. So Sri Aurobindo uses that idea. Of course, Sri Aurobindo does not accept the evolution that we know in science. what Sri Aurobindo says is that there is some kind of evolution. Okay. And it is different from the what is taught in the science, because in Sri Aurobindo's idea, from time to time, there is a sudden change in on earth in life forms. So there is a sudden change in which there is a jump in the level of consciousness. So that is how man has eventually evolved. And similarly, in the future also, the higher consciousness will also evolve within man. So this is Sri Aurobindo's very unique contribution of the existence of the seven principles of existence, Bhur, Bhuvah, Svaha, Maha, etc. And the idea of the evolutionary principle working within man. So therefore, we'll get that later. So Brahman and Jivatman. So as we have already seen, it is the supreme being itself. It imagines itself. It forms infinite centers of concentrations of consciousness within the supermind. Okay, and that is how each jivatma, because of its being identical to the supreme being, is able to enjoy complete unity with all other jivatmans and also with Brahman and also with all other objects in the universe. Okay, so this is the key to understanding the Upanishads. This is the key to understanding the understanding of the supermind is the key to understanding the Advaita that the Upanishads teaches. So again, as I said before, in the bottom I've written, the experience of all in one, one in all, and the manifestation of all from the one is the defining nature of every Jivatman. So there is an individual Brahman, the cosmic Brahman, and the transcendental Brahman at the same time. So the Jiva, so because the Jiva is identical with the Brahman, just like Brahman, the liberated Jiva can experience all these three at the same time. Okay, the individual, the cosmic, and the transcendent. All right, and hence, based on Sri Aurobindo's description of the Jivatma and the supermind, we can very easily understand why Tattvamasi makes complete sense. We don't have to resort to any fancy interpretation. It is there in the very description of the supermind and the jiva, in the nature of the Jivatma, Tattvamasi. So in another place, the Upanishad says, Brahma, the person who realizes Brahma becomes Brahma. Yes, of course, because each Jivatma is identical to Brahma. It's the same Brahma who is sitting in infinite centers of consciousness. Because, you know, it is the absolute, it has this absolute power to be many, many Jivas at the same time without losing its fundamental unity. Of course, this you have to read, if one reads the, there are two or three chapters on the supermind. If you read that, one will get a much deeper idea of that. It forms the crux of the life divine, and also it forms the crux of the Upanishads also. This is what most people do not understand. That unless you fully understand the supramental consciousness, you won't understand the nature of this manifestation of Jagat and Jiva. If you do not understand that, then you will not understand Upanishads altogether. You will have piecemeal idea about this and that, and one can, you know, one can, of course, based on one's own conviction, be able to write about it and write detailed explanations and give pramanas as to why my view is the correct view. All right. So why we are ignorant? Here also there is a difference. So you know, in our traditional Vedanta, all acharyas are unified in saying that it is anadikarma that is responsible for our ignorance. Right. So after pralaya, in each srishti, the jivas return to Brahman in their unmanifested form and are manifested again in a new cycle to continue their experience of samsara. Okay. Only those who attain moksha are not born again. This is the traditional view. So, see, in Sri Aurobindo's integral Advaita, based on what I have deduced, it is as follows. So there is a recognition that there is a long period of evolution of creatures on earth, and the very process of evolution ensures that every creature, including human being, in his long history on this planet earth through many births, is outside oriented. So the mind, the intellect, the sense organs are always oriented outside. Paranchi Khani, Vyatranath Swayambhu, in the Katha Upanishad, the Rishi says that the God has destroyed our sense organs by making it always directed outside. So the Upanishad is saying that in a particular way. So it is saying that, so what we have to understand is that for the purpose of survival and continuation of the species, the jivas have had to be outside looking. Otherwise, the human species would not have survived. Okay. So now that we have evolved and come to a certain stage, we are in a position to turn our gaze inwards. And the same shloka, the Kathopanishad says, Paranchi Khani Vyatranath Swayambhu Tasmat Paran Pashyati Natu Arvan. So because our senses are all directed outside, everybody sees outside only and not inside. But then in the same mantra it says, Kaschid Dhiraham Pratyagatmanam Aikshatam Avritta Chakshur Amritatvam Ichchan. So it is only the rare human being who is desiring of immortality, who turns his gaze inwards and then finally realizes his true self. So this is the status of human beings on earth. We are naturally outside looking and hence ignorant of our real nature. And that is also the result of the development of our false Atma, the Kritrim Atma, which we also call as ego. So this ego survives from birth to birth for us. So all the karma that we do, the samskara sticks to us, and we may go to other lokas or maybe immediately reborn on earth, etc., etc. But that ego continues as long as we are outward looking. And this is the cause and nature of our ignorance, this long period of evolution in which, due to sheer necessity of survival of ourselves and continuation of the species, that every creature is outside looking and ignorant, including human being. But as the Upanishads teach us, we humans have the capacity to change the direction of that vision from outside to inside. So Vedanta teaches us to disengage from the outside world and look inside. And in the traditional idea, so when you realize your true self, that destroys the karma phala. So all the accumulated karma phala gets destroyed. And the end of this particular birth, when the person passes away, he attains to Brahman and is not born again. So here, this again is a very important and unique contribution in terms of the nature of ignorance, or rather how the ignorance comes about, how to overcome ignorance. So this again is a very huge topic in Sri Aurobindo's integral Advaita. That is the integral yoga. The process of integral yoga is the process of overcoming this ignorance. Not only overcoming ignorance. See, in the traditional idea, the idea is to get beyond this ego, that is the ignorance, and attain moksha, freedom from birth. But as we all know, Sri Aurobindo has a different vision. He says that the purpose of human being is to attain perfection here on earth. And the way to do it is by means of what is called as the triple transformation. We will see that. And in Sri Aurobindo's doctrine, this is another unique contribution of the individual soul as the psychic being. Okay, So what is this psychic being? This psychic being is not exactly the Jivatma that we saw in the supermind, which is identical to Brahman and always in a state of mukti. But this psychic being in the human is a spark of the Jivatman. Okay, that has entered into this creature, and this spark develops a physical, vital, and mental human consciousness as its instruments of world experience and of a disguised, imperfect, and growing self-expression. So this psychic being is the means of evolving here on earth for the jiva. Okay, so the jiva puts out a small particle or a spark of itself as the psychic being, as the which forms the essence of the psychic being or the core of the psychic being, and in each birth of the human being, the psychic being develops its spiritual personality from birth to birth, and through all the experiences on earth, it is able to gather the ananda, the truth, and the ananda of all the experiences, and it accumulates that experience and grows in its spiritual personality. So more and more the spiritual personality becomes enlightened with regards to the human life on earth. So more and more it becomes enlightened with regards to dealing with the ups and downs of human life, about sukha dukkha and all the dualities. And slowly it matures until at some point the psychic being, the spiritual personality of this, that is the psychic being, matures so much that it completes, it takes charge of the human being. So then the human being is no longer trapped in his ego. So he has gone beyond the limited ego, and he is able to have the real understanding of life on earth. Okay, so as Sri Aurobindo says, it can come forward explicitly and replace the limited ego and harmonize the working of the mind, life, and body. So this is the growth of the psychic being, that is the first step in the triple transformation that Sri Aurobindo has predicted of man on earth. So the first is the psychic transformation. So in the case of Sri Aurobindo's integral Vedanta or integral yoga, moksha is not the goal. It is the perfection of the entire being of man. Annamaya, pranamaya, manomaya, vijnanamaya, kosha. All of them should reach its peak of perfection. That is the state of immortality here on earth. So that is the final goal which Sri Aurobindo envisions of man. So in the triple transformation, the first is the psychic transformation, in which the individual becomes completely in control of itself as it goes beyond the ego and is able to balance the needs of the body, mind, and the life force. Okay, so once the psychic transformation happens, then the body, the jiva, is ready for the spiritual transformation, where the descent of the higher peace, force, light, etc., from the plane of the overmental consciousness descends into the human, and the separateness of I is gone and replaced by the experience of the universal self or unity. So this corresponds, as Sri Aurobindo says, to the moksha in the traditional view, that in the spiritual transformation, the cosmic oneness is realized, the unity with all other beings, and in the unity with the whole of cosmos. This is realized in the spiritual transformation. How? Because of the aspiration of the individual, by the individual sadhana, as well as by the grace of the higher consciousness which descends. So when that happens, the cosmic consciousness dawns in the individual. This is the second step, or the spiritual transformation. The third one is, of course, the final and the last transformation, the supramental transformation, in which that same process of aspiration, of ascent of the human consciousness upwards by aspiration, and the descent of the supramental consciousness, when both happen, there is a divinization of the entire being of the individual, and indeed of all the race, the entire human race. And slowly, in due course of time, the purpose of the manifestation of the universe will be fulfilled when the Supreme Being realizes its perfection on earth here in this universe. Okay, so there is physical immortality also, but then so here is where some people who really do not fully understand Sri Aurobindo, they say this is all materialistic. What is this? Why physical immortality? That is very tuccha. That is very low. So what is this Sri Aurobindo is saying? But the right way to understand is that this physical immortality is a side effect of the descent of the higher consciousness. Okay. So the goal, so the Sri Aurobindo has seen a higher purpose of this manifestation. Not just moksha, but of perfection here on earth. And for that perfection, the supramental consciousness has to descend fully on earth. Okay, and that can happen by the individual sadhana of people who follow this particular truths as propounded by Sri Aurobindo and do the sadhana in an appropriate way. So when that happens, there is perfection here on earth of the individual and of gradually of the entire human. So a lot of questions arise. What will each person be like? Will they all be same? Will they be different, etc., etc.? And Sri Aurobindo has answered that question to a large extent in The Life Divine, that there will still be individuality of the human being. Okay, that will not be lost. But the human race will become gradually enlightened as a race, as opposed to being ignorant as a race right now. So moving on. So how to overcome? So the Sri Aurobindo's methods are well known to his followers by the method of aspiration, rejection, or surrender, or faith, aspiration, and surrender. So this is a very active sadhana. There is surrender, of course, but there is also daily awareness of daily awareness of what is needed and what is not needed, what is good and what is bad, what helps the sadhana and what hinders the sadhana, and by active rejection of all that is not divine and that is not conducive to the supramental yoga. So by constant aspiration, rejection and surrender, one can proceed in this sadhana. So so what is aspiration? So here also one must understand that a steadfast longing for a higher goal, earnest desire for something above oneself, that is aspiration. So for that, one has to have an understanding of what is higher. Only then one can aspire to it. Right. So this in a very, very short summary is the about the how to overcome ignorance or the practice or the sadhana. Of course, Sri Aurobindo's recommended method is complete surrender to the mother. So there are two ways, one by knowledge and by one's own efforts, and the other by reliance on the mother. So the mother, Sri Mata, as Sri Aurobindo has told, has taught us, is the embodiment of the Shakti, divine Shakti. And surrendering to her completely and relying on her grace to advance us in our transformation. That is the most easiest way. And that is what a lot of Sri Aurobindo's followers, that is the a type of sadhana that they all perform in their daily lives. And of course, one very important teaching of Sri Aurobindo is that the sadhana is not something that one has to do by going, by living in a cave or by living in a jungle or something, but it has to be lived in every second of our lives. So this complete surrender to the divine and allowing the divine to manifest itself and be ever ready to follow the inner voice and let the divine manifest its desire in our actions, in our karma, so that the goal is eventually to do divine work in this world, in every waking moment of our lives here. So it is something that has to be done in every waking moment of our lives, and not something that is opposed or something that is removed from our everyday lives. So this is also a very unique feature of Sri Aurobindo's yoga. So our perception of reality, again, as the life divine tells us, that we have only a partial view of the truth. It is our view of the truth is not wrong. It is partial. It is Vedanta that completes our view. Okay. So the purpose of the Vedanta is to enlighten us, to furnish the missing parts of our knowledge. That is what the Bhagavad Gita also does, isn't it? It completes our knowledge about ourselves, who we are, our relationship with the Supreme Being, and the nature of human life, etc., etc., and what we have to do to realize our full potential here as divine beings and not as ignorant, miserable creatures. All right. So finally, what is the diversity of human swabhava, karma, rebirth, etc.? So one thing that Sri Aurobindo has very clearly always said that about diversity, that diversity is an intrinsic quality of the manifestation. There is no need to look further than that. So individuals are different because that is the very nature of manifestation. There is no need to look anywhere else beyond that. And that diversity is reflected in the growth of our psychic, in our spiritual personality over course of many lives. So the free variation and diversity is the very nature of the manifestation. Okay. So this diversity in human swabhava is reflected in the diversity of the growth of the psychic being. So the individual soul, the psychic being, okay, is the controller of our individual lives. And what experience we have in our lives, what karma we do, actually depends upon the need of the soul. As we will see in the next slide, Sri Aurobindo says that all the secrets and of circumstances of rebirth center around the capital need of the soul. And what is that need of the soul? The need of growth, the need of experience that governs the line of its evolution. Evolution of the individual soul, the psychic being that is growing within us. So what it needs? So it needs experience. So it governs the line of its evolution, and all the rest is accessory. The law of karma does not determine the destiny of the soul. It's the other way around. It is the soul which uses the law as one of its instruments. Okay. So karma is not a mechanical law, which is the general common sense understanding of karma. He says that the law of karma does not determine the destiny of the soul. It is the soul which uses the law of karma as one of its instruments. Thus, karma cannot work as an impediment to spiritual freedom. As one proceeds toward higher and higher evolution, the grip of this mechanical law gradually breaks down, and the individual attains more and more spiritual freedom. So as the psychic being is evolving, yes, karma is there and karma phala is also there. But in each life, okay, it is this, the psychic being that dictates the nature of our experience in this world. So in strictly speaking, in Sri Aurobindo's vision, each human birth, each rebirth has to build upon what happened in the previous birth. Okay, so Sri Aurobindo is not inclined to agree that after once taking human birth, the soul will go back to being an animal or a plant or something else. He does not fully agree with that. He says that maybe that will happen only in very rare cases where the tamas is so great that the soul has no option but to, in order to satisfy that tamas, it has to take the birth of an animal in order to fulfill the needs of this needs of the soul, because it is in that particular state of tamas. So he says that, but from what I read in the Life Divine, in his view, each birth of the human being has to build upon what happened earlier in the previous life and move little bit slowly higher and higher. So what is the status of jiva after moksha? In Aurobindo's case, he does not accept the moksha as the last word of the purpose of human life on earth. So in the integral Advaita, the jiva is never in bandha. The jiva is never in ignorance, because it is always in a liberated state, in eternal union with the Supreme Being. It is never part of the evolutionary process on earth. So the spiritual evolution that goes on earth, it happens because of the the growth of the psychic being, which grows in spiritual personality in each birth, and at some point causes the person to go beyond the ego and seek his true self. And finally, of course, then you have the other transformations also. So moksha is not the goal of the integral Advaita in Sri Aurobindo's vision of Vedanta. In his unique reading of Vedanta, it is an advance of what one can say, that it is an advance on what the Upanishad says. Because the Upanishads also, mostly, if you read the Ishadi 10 Upanishads, they all talks about to end this cycle of rebirths. But Sri Aurobindo has given us a different vision, which includes that also. As he always says, moksha is always possible. But in his view, that is not the purpose of man on earth. It is to attain perfection. So that is what he says in the final question. What is the purpose of the manifestation of universe by Brahman and the purpose of man in the universe? It is to attain perfection. So through the form of the human being, the Supreme Being seeks perfection here on earth through many lives. And that perfection can happen with the eventual descent of the supramental consciousness into man, thus leading to the divinization of all the parts of the, all the koshas of the human being. And that will herald the eventual dawn of the immortal divine life of man on earth. So that is the great hope and vision that Sri Aurobindo offers to all of mankind. All right, so that finishes the, in summary, Sri Aurobindo's integral Advaita. It is integral because it does not let go of any part of the manifestation, nor does it let go of the transcendental. That is, the transcendental is there, the cosmic is there, the individual is there, and the idea is to gain perfection of all the parts of being, all the planes of consciousness must find their full expression within man. Okay, the physical consciousness, life consciousness, mental, and the vijnana or the supramental consciousness. So nothing is left out. All the planes of consciousness of the manifestation of the Supreme Being are to attain perfection within the human being. That is the integrality of the integral Advaita. Why is it Advaita? Obviously, because as what Sri Aurobindo propounds is perfectly in tune with the Upanishads, that there is a grand unity between the Brahman, Jiva and Jagat. Inseparable, they are all one. So, and the last question we have already answered, what is the purpose of man, etc., etc. So, okay, so what are the problems solved by Sri Aurobindo? This is another way of looking at it. So, these are the unique contributions by Sri Aurobindo in which he has advanced by leaps and bounds our understanding of the Upanishads. In the first place, is not Brahman only consciousness and will? No, there is also Shakti. Brahman is also infinite energy or Shakti. So all the other Acharyas have posed this question that Brahman cannot be the material cause of the universe, because that will mean that just like the wood changes into a table or chair, or the lump of clay changes into pots and pans and etc. Similarly, Brahman has to change to become this universe and jivas. But that is not possible, because how can Brahman change? It is changeless. But that argument is not correct, because first of all, what I think, this is my opinion, in my humble opinion, in the traditional view, they have not understood the full implication of the implication of Anantyam, infinity. The Supreme Being is infinite in its knowledge, Shakti, etc., etc. So he can be the material cause of not one but infinite number of universe, but still it will remain unchanged only, because all the, what we call as change, we understand based on our understanding of our ordinary human life on earth. And then we are saying, oh, how can Brahman change? So what Sri Aurobindo is saying is that don't apply your ordinary standards to the Supreme Being. It is of an entirely different kind. Its consciousness is different. Its Shakti is different. It is an entirely different thing. So when we say our consciousness and the consciousness of the Supreme Being, that they are different. So the infinities of the Supreme Being ensures that it remains changeless even after manifesting any number of universes. Its unity and its changelessness remains unabrogated. Going back to this analogy of the lump of clay and the pots and pans, just like the lump of clay knows that all the pots and the vigraha and whatever is made of the lump of clay, the lump of clay knows that I am only there in various forms. No difference, it's myself only the form is different and the name is different based on the need of Vyavahara. Similarly, the Brahman knows that all these galaxies and stars and planets and all this infinite variety of creatures and all, it is I am only that. No difference. I will give you one example. Suppose you take a block of wood, okay, and cut that block of wood into two pieces. And you leave one piece as it is and burn the other piece. So what happens is you will get a pile of ashes. So you have one piece of wood as it is and you have a pile of ashes. For us, they are totally different, is it not? They are totally different. But from the point of Brahman, it is the same thing, because it knows that even the ashes is made up of myself only. Just like the lump of clay knows that the pots and the pans and the vigraha, they are all made of myself. It's just a rearrangement of the clay particles. That is what the lump of clay knows. Similarly, Brahman knows that all of this is a rearrangement of myself. I am only there everywhere. In every particle, in every nook and corner, there is nothing in this universe, not even a single minutest corner, that is not me. So Brahman knows everything as itself. And therefore, the person who realizes Brahman also comes to the same position. That is exactly what the Upanishad says. In the Mundaka Upanishad, Yohavai Paramam Brahma Veda Brahmaiva Bhavati. He who knows Brahman becomes Brahman. Alright. So all these things become so clear once you understand the all the truths that Sri Aurobindo has laid out to us in his major works. So the unity and the changelessness of Brahman remains unabrogated. Okay, even in the infinite diversity. The Supreme Being is infinitely one. He is one in an infinite number of ways. So then the next question, Saguna, Nirguna, Niguna. No, there is no contradiction at all. Those who see contradiction between Saguna and Nirguna, they are thinking in ordinary human terms. They have not realized the actual Brahman. So the person who really understands the full measure of Brahman, Yo Mam Janati Tattvataha, in the Sri Aurobindo points this statement from the Bhagavad Gita. Yo Mam Janati Tattvataha, as I am. I am the one and I am the infinite. I am the multiple. I am the diversity also. That is what we are challenged. That is the challenge that the Upanishads are giving us. And in my opinion, it is Sri Aurobindo who has finally told us how, or given us a way to understand these great truths of the Upanishad that seem contradictory only if you look at the surface. Okay, so there is really no contradiction. The contradiction appears because of our incompleteness of our realization, of our knowledge. So Brahman is beyond gunas and forms, but is capable of manifesting infinite gunas and infinite forms. This is the absolute power of the absolute. One may worship either Saguna or Nirguna, depending upon whatever one chooses. Is the number of jivas one or many? This is another question that has been answered differently by different acharyas, because they have, I think, thought mainly through the process of logic. Whereas Sri Aurobindo, by his more comprehensive spiritual realizations, has shown us how the number of jivas may be infinite, because each of them is a Brahman itself, is identical to Brahman. In what way it is? One has to understand the manifestation, and within that, the role of the supermind and the nature of the supermind. So therefore, the jivas can be infinite numbers, and they each will have their own ananda and own unique view of itself and the other jivas and of the Brahman. But at the same time, it will always know its unity with everything also. It is never lost. So one and the many at the same time. That is the great secret of the Upanishad. So everybody says that Upanishad means secret, Upanishad. So it is the secret that the Shishya learns by sitting near the Guru and listening to the Guru and finally realizing it. But what is that secret? This is that great secret. This is the great unity that the Upanishad teaches very plainly. Tattvamasi, it says, Sarvam hi etat Brahma. In the Taittiriya, I think, Sarvam hi etat Brahma, I am Atma Brahma. Two things it says immediately. All this is Brahman. We have seen how Sri Aurobindo has explained it. They are forms of Brahman, yes. But Brahman need not change. We cannot apply our idea of change to Brahman. Okay. So there can be infinite jivas, infinite objects in the universe, etc., etc. Okay. So Sarvam Hetat Brahma. All this is Brahman. All the jivas and they are Brahman only. Furthermore, I am Atma Brahman. The individual Atma is also Brahman. How? That we have seen. So multiple jivas and the relation to Brahman. This is also a big puzzle to all the traditional commentators. What is the relation of jivas to Brahman? So Shankaracharya takes an extreme view, as all other commentators have said that Shankara takes a very extreme view. He simply removes the Jiva and Brahma, Jiva and Jagat altogether as mithya, and says that in the ultimate reality, only Brahman exists. There are really no multiple Jivas. They are a product of ignorance. And in Vishishtadvaita and Dvaita, they say that each Jiva, though they share something of the qualities of the Brahman, knowledge and Ananda, but still they are totally different from each other. And they also say that the Brahman cannot be the material cause of the universe because it cannot change, etc., etc. Furthermore, why is there such diversity in human swabhava and individual? It is so in Sri Aurobindo's scheme of things, diversity is the very nature of manifestation. And that the diversity is reflected in the psychic being and how the psychic being grows from birth to birth. Again, the capital need of the soul is the need of growth, experience, etc., and that governs the line of its evolution. So from birth to birth, the human being, the psychic being grows based on its needs of varieties of experience. Furthermore, how does avidya or ignorance rise in mind? We have already seen this. The long period of evolution of creatures is the cause, etc., is the cause of ignorance, etc. What is the purpose of universe and man? Here, Sri Aurobindo has a very, 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 very different view compared to everybody else, all the other commentators and all the other darshanas. He says that purpose of human being is to not to escape from life, moksha. That is always there. But he sees a higher purpose, is a different and a more higher purpose and a deeper purpose, which is that Brahman seeks perfection through a gradual purpose of evolution in the form of the divine life of man, and that can happen by the descent of the supramental consciousness, etc. So these are the what I have said as problems solved by Aurobindo. So I say problems because all of these questions, in fact, all those 9 points that we saw, are they are all in a sense 9 different questions. What is the swarupa of Brahman, Jagat, Jiva? What is the mutual relationship? What is this nature of ignorance? Why it arises? How it can go? Etc. etc. All these are questions. And all the our traditional commentators have answered their question, those questions in their own unique way, based on their understanding and their sadhana. But mostly they have relied on the process of dialectics and by the process of logic. Pramana, they have used Shastra to justify their own particular view, their own particular darshana. Whereas Sri Aurobindo takes an entirely different route. So he, so as he to repeat what he has said, life divine is not philosophy but fact. It contains all that I have seen and experienced. So in other words, Sri Aurobindo has taken the path of the Vedic Rishi. Okay, and hence we know what we know. We are much more enlightened because of the grace of Sri Aurobindo and what he has done for us. So I will rest here. So this completes my presentation. It's already 8:30. So but I'm still open for any questions.
ಸರ್ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ
ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಹೇಳಿ.
ಎಲ್ಲ ನೀವು ಬಹುತೇಕ ಯಾರು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಕೇಳೋಂಗಿಲ್ಲ, ಎಲ್ಲ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ನೀವು ನೀವೇ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಕೇಳಿ.